City Planning Commission, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this evening's meeting. We do have a quorum, so we will get right into the agenda. Those of you that are presenting this evening, if you have not already done so, please sign in. And we will be taking public comment on a per-project basis. There will not be any opportunity for general commentary before or after the projects that are coming before us. We will take comment only during project-specific session. First item on the agenda is the acceptance of the July 2019 Planning Commission agenda. Are there any additions or corrections to be made to this agenda this evening?
Chairman, there is one. I'm going to need to amend the name of the architects for the Berks Humane Society to...
Meiser.
Yes.
Cox Meiser.
The new gentleman, who's their new engineer. I have their architect on there from the past meeting.
Okay.
So I'll have to amend that.
Which one did I get?
That would be the first one.
Oh, the first one, okay.
Oh, you mean DH Enterprises?
DH, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, any other additions or corrections? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to accept the Planning Commission agenda for July 19 as slightly amended.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. Okay, item number 2A under subdivisions and land development plans to be presented this evening. The first one is a preliminary / final for Humane Society of Berks County. I am Matt. The rest of your team here?
Unfortunately, the rest of my team is all out of town, so hopefully I can answer all the questions that you've got. Prep to me to an extent.
Okay. I guess, Tim, the best thing we'll do is we'll go to you first.
Okay.
Any opportunity to review what the Humane Society brought before us?
Sure.
Sure. And your comments.
Like I mentioned, the review letter from Public Works was issued a little bit late. It came out late this morning, early afternoon, I don't know when. Two-pager, I don't know if you got a chance to review it or not. Did the applicant get a chance to review this? I'm not sure it got...
I think we got it.
It got to the architect, to Meiser, but I could not get Michael Hartman's email. For some reason, I looked all over. I don't have Michael's email address. I apologize for that. I meant to send it to him.
Have it come to think of it. No, I don't think he actually did get a chance to see it then.
Okay. So it's 15 comments. I'll try to condense this and get to the meat of it, since we don't have some of these are technical, but it could relate to a property owner issue with the technical items. So I'll bring that one up. Just to let you know, this plan is a new plan. It's a preliminary final plan, and it now shows the second story footprint that's going to be involved, as we just heard described the last time. So now it looks like it's at least 5,000 square foot of new impervious area that's being developed on this lot. There's some of the property outbuildings are being removed, so the net impervious area is actually less than what it is currently. And the engineer for the applicant took that advantage and was able to demonstrate that the runoff is actually going to be less than what it was prior to the stormwater management ordinance, which means that a drainage plan would not be required. They're not applying for an exemption this time. They're simply saying that the runoff is going to be less than what it is currently because of the decrease in impervious area, the increase of perviousness, which is a fair, that's another way to do it. It's fair. It's a fair way to go, and I have no problem with that. However, there still is stormwater issues to be dealt with. There's the water quality, the groundwater, and the stream bank protection, which they addressed in a stormwater management plan that they submitted. And just reminding that application stormwater review application needs to be submitted with a fee. Okay, there's a fee associated with the application. We'll need to see that. There's a problem I'm seeing with the way the grading is on the plan, and it ties into this stormwater. Because the intent of the stormwater, and I like the idea that it's more green grass, it's vegetative filtration, rather than sticking an infiltration bed under the parking lot, which is what most people do in the city, because there's nowhere else to go with it, because it's all impervious. This proposal, most of the white area that you see up there, I don't want to do the presentation, other than the driveway, is going to be green space, and it's going to be amended soil, which is nice. I like that. When you can afford it, you know, use it and make it a BMP and then use it to your advantage. And there's going to be a swale that's going to get put in. There we go.
Is that better?
Yeah, you can't see the swale, but it's on the north side, and it runs from the parking area, if you can tell where the parking area is there, out towards 11th Street. And so the idea is to take all the runoff from this impervious area, collect it all and send it over into that swale, have it go through the green space, through the vegetated swale. This is a Pennsylvania DEP acknowledged BMP for treating stormwater. It's good. The problem is, the way the grading is right now, it's not going that direction. It all wants to go to the northeast corner of the property. It's all grading that way. And if you're familiar with that, is that the current condition? Do you often see runoff going toward the northeast corner?
We do not.
Interesting, because it's a 2-foot hole over there.
And as I remember this, on the previous plan submission to this, Andrew complained about the swale on the north side of the property.
Well, there's no swale there now, but I don't know if you
well, the one
can't
that was,
really see it too
the
well.
One that was supposed to be
right up
in.
Here there's a low point, and all the drainage goes to that low point, and it wants to go this way, and it can't because there's a hump in the grading. And I haven't had a chance to talk with Mr. Hartman about it, but that issue in my mind needs to be explained. I'm not comfortable with that yet. Everything else works, but that one issue there needs to be addressed.
So if I have him address the swale issue to get it sloped to appropriate
well,
direction?
Well, I'm not even saying sloping it. I'll let the engineer figure out. And I don't want to tell him how to do it. I know how I do it.
It's interesting. I've been there 15 years. We've never had puddle.
You've never had a puddle or anything over there?
No.
Interesting.
Nothing of any significance. Okay. I mean, like driveway puddling, but like literally.
I checked on my GIS, right. And it has not as good a survey as this. It has 2-foot contours. And it seems to back this survey. This survey seems accurate.
Okay.
So it seems to indicate that there is a low point there.
Interesting.
And it unfortunately spreads over into the neighbor to the north.
Well, that was my next question.
The
neighbor
Richmond.
To the north, the parking lot has sort of grown over the years with gravel. I'm wondering whether or not the backfill that appears to have happened on that side may have accounted for. That's good. I'll have them look at it.
I don't know. Yeah, the other thing too is you notice there's that dark dashed line that runs along the northern property line.
Yeah.
And it makes a little bump to the north and encroaches into the neighbor. I think Richmond is the neighbor?
Yeah.
Yeah, to the Richmond property. And so that needs to be addressed. Is that real or is that just an accident?
I think that's an accident. Yeah, it's literally a chain link fence wall.
Right.
And it's like literally sort of
right.
grown with gravel backfill.
I know that this neighbor is sensitive, so we want to make sure we protect your
I'll
interest
sure
there.
That's
so
taken care of.
That's something that appears on my letter. We had, as a staff, a pretty good discussion among planning and zoning and public works, and we all agreed that this site also needs to be accessible. You have sidewalks on the west side, on the 11th Street side, but there are no sidewalks on the Burn Street. And unless the Planning Commission sees otherwise, staff is recommending that you add sidewalks.
That was actually one of our questions. There is an existing sidewalk now, and there's nothing that anybody goes to beyond where the existing corner sidewalk is. We're questioning why what the accessibility need would be when there is nothing up the block and the only entrance is being made use of is actually on the 11th Street side.
It's a legitimate question, but I guess because that's the way the zoning ordinance requires it.
Actually, when I was a student at Albright, we used to go to the Humane Society all the time and walk right over that grass strip to go walk the dogs.
There's some nonconformities in that neighborhood. I agree with what you're saying, what you're seeing. Okay. It's not the way it should be. They shouldn't have to do that. There should be a sidewalk all the way down to Albright, but there isn't.
Okay.
And we see the Humane Society as being a pedestrian destination. There's some other destinations over there, like the truck parking lot, which wouldn't necessarily be a pedestrian destination.
But theoretically, if the argument is they're coming from Albright, they're proceeding down that direction to get to our brand new sidewalk, yet they don't have a sidewalk on that end. So,
yeah. Yeah.
I mean, if we're required to have it, we understand, but it's basically an additional expense when the for-profit company across the street, I don't believe, has a sidewalk. And actually, our next question is going to be about the handicap ramps that nobody has, but
right.
We will be apparently now putting that as well.
Yeah, you read my letter.
Yeah, that somebody read that part because they asked me to ask about
right.
it.
Right. I didn't understand it until this morning, and I talked to our zoning administrator who explained that you're actually using the parking on the opposite side, on the southern side of the southern lot that you own, the Humane Society's property on the south side of Burns Street, and that you'll be using as parking for parking on this lot.
Well, people may use it, but street parking is what's currently used, and there's no change in staffing. There's no change in personnel of clients using it. So it's actually exactly existing. Yet mm-hmm. we've been working fine with the with the street parking. The additional parking lot is primarily for a veterinary hospital, and it can be used, but it's not actually,
where I speak for Public Works, mm-hmm. and we deal with the on-street, and that's one of the issues,
okay.
but I don't want to step on Adam's toes here, too, because he deals with on-street parking and zoning, and that's why I wanted to get a clarification, because it's being reviewed as a land development plan.
Okay.
Land development, unless you get a variance, you're required to meet parking regulations.
Okay. Well, again, that was our question. If it's required, we'll obviously do it. But as a charity, I'm the one that has to keep asking each of these like $10,000 and $20,000 additions that we're going to have to figure out where to raise funds for if it's actually required.
And the city Public Works has to view this too. So we can't just issue on-street parking unless we see that there's a need and that the residential demand for parking will allow it.
Right.
It looks like you could probably continue using the on-street parking. But then there's also the requirement for on-site parking, which we have to get, particularly ADA accessible on-site parking. And I will stress that the accessible parking is really becoming more and more, if it isn't already, it's becoming more and more an issue.
Okay.
Because it is a federal regulation. It's not a building code, it's federal
right.
regulation. And
okay.
so the city takes that pretty seriously. And so it's not only protect the city, it's to protect the,
right.
the residents and the property owners.
Okay. Well, if we have to do it, we have to do it. But like I said, our aim is to not do things we don't have to do to save funds for the animals.
So the comment that I'm going to make about the curb ramps then is if, in fact, you do have accessible parking on the south lot, then you need to have an accessible pedestrian route to get from the parking lot to the destination.
Okay.
Which means there needs to be two curb ramps, one at the south, southeast, southeast, and northeast corners.
Okay. There is an existing handicap accessible parking ramp on the front of the building, which we don't intend on moving. That can't serve as adequate handicap parking.
Say it again now.
There's an existing pull-off ramp that allows people to directly access our front door.
On 11th Street?
On 11th Street.
Yeah, that looks like a driveway. Is that an old driveway apron?
I'm not sure what it ever was because there was never a part of a house there that had it, but it was installed, and that's what it's basically been used for, is that sort of accessibility.
Yeah, I don't know if the commission understands what we're talking about right now. Adam, did you get a picture?
You can see that
right
there is a apron there on the left picture, closest to the edge.
Here?
No, left photo.
Left side.
Oh, here.
Right there.
There you go.
That's the front of the building.
Yeah.
And that's the apron. That's a bus stop there, too, I think.
I'm not sure if people use it for bus
stop. I remember seeing a sign there on Street View.
Okay.
So you're saying you would use...
Well, I don't know if that would be adequate for, you know, getting us past the requirements for numbers of spots, but that's actually something that people do actually use for handicap accessibility because it gets them directly to the front door of the building.
Yeah.
Still going to need the corners because, you know, even if you, I'm not sure what the parking situation is there on North 11th Street, but, I mean, if that area is congested or already parked and that's the only accessible point for ADA compliance, you're still going to need the corners.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm saying too that the on-site parking requires ADA accessibility. Unless somehow that was a variance, it would seem odd because it is a federal regulation that you have accessible parking. I don't see the zoning hearing board, you know, making a variance on that.
If I could jump in on the parking, can we go back to the slide? So as far as accessible parking spaces, do you have any now?
Yes.
And they're on the lot across the street?
Yes, we have the lot across the street marked.
Okay. And does that meet zoning, do you know?
It was part of the requirement. I think we got the building first time, so it's got the full van access.
Right. But when you say first time, how long?
4 years ago.
Four? Okay, yeah. Just four. All right. So you should be compliant. My concern is that, so did zoning look at the site on the north side with the site on the south side where they combine, because if they're separate parcels, then it wasn't looked at as one parcel.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So did you get zoning hearing board to just have parking as a use on that lot because there's no other primary use?
I would imagine so, but honestly, I don't recall.
We'd have to check it out. So we might need an offline discussion just on zoning matters because obviously the parking is an issue, is a concern. Sidewalk is a concern, and we can talk through that because in the parking lot to the east, the asphalt kind of right up almost to the street, if I'm correct, I believe it is. Right?
That's another issue. Right. That's not their property.
Not yours. Okay.
This is theirs.
So zoning is looking into that. Okay.
Well, zoning is looking into this one.
Right. That's, and that. Separate issue. Okay,
actually, while this is pictures up, this is one of my questions. The hump that's there on the left picture on the right, at the left-hand side, if it turns out that because of improvements to the neighbor's property, that's why we're not seeing puddling because stuff got filled in, so now your map is no longer accurate. Is that just something that we would have Michael Hartman deal with you guys on? Because it may not be that 2-foot hole is a reality anymore because of what has been done.
It seems odd that Michael, because he's, I mean, he knows what he's doing,
right?
And that he would show that, and yet I'm looking at something that doesn't show what he's intending.
Right.
And it all wraps around a really good idea. I just need him to tell me how it's going to work.
Okay.
And maybe that's the case. Maybe in reality is not what is exactly showing on the contour map.
I'll talk to him about that.
Yeah. And it's funny that you're not seeing water ponding because you should be, unless it's really draining well over there.
Yeah, and we get a lot of water. I mean, when it rains, it's
especially this year.
Yeah.
That's all I had.
Anything from any of the commission members? Anything more from staff or David?
As of this point, have Michael give us a call.
Okay.
We'll set up a meeting. You know, we'll meet down at Public Works. It's easier for Tim, but you can go from there.
Do that.
And I think his only question was if he incorporates these corrections in once he meets with you, can we get approval as resubmitted, or do we have to go through a whole meeting cycle again?
Well, they're going to defer decision. That's the recommendation.
Okay.
That's to defer decision.
Fantastic.
You just come back.
Okay.
Yeah.
The revised plans to make them prior to, so we'll review them, and we'll get you on. You can make it by next month.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah, he can certainly do that.
That means we need the plans in about 2 weeks.
I think he got it faster last time, so
yeah,
he's trying to help.
Yeah,
us
it's
out,
pretty
so
quick. Yeah, we don't have any planning modules, no outside permitting, no NPDES or HOP or anything like that, so I don't think anything would stop you from getting it.
Okay, great.
Oh, the approval. There is one thing that just occurred to me. If that area that you occasionally use for handicap access, are people actually parking there?
Occasionally people do. I mean, it's as needed. Occasionally somebody that's, you know, okay, has trouble getting around and right.
Because
less pleasantly that, somebody has to like bring a body in or something.
I'm just saying that it winds up on the plan that it's being used as handicapped accessibility, you're going to need a city drive. Make sure you have a city driveway permit for that.
If you're going to use it, it probably already has a driveway permit since it's there. Now, it may not, but it should have one. If you're going to use it for ADA accessibility, then it should be checked to make sure that the slopes meet
right.
U.S. Access Board's
criteria. If we have to do it for everything
criteria.
Else, we're yeah. going to comply in the various other places right. we need to do it properly.
I mean, are people driving into this or parking on the street and just using it for better access?
Generally, some people actually pull into it. We've never been thrilled that's been the use, but it's been, it predates all of us that work there.
I'm glad you brought that, because I'm picturing somebody parking on the street and using it as a ramp.
No, people literally are pulling up.
They're pulling
up. So if they're very old or something,
I'm sorry, I misunderstood what you were saying. Yeah. Okay, I didn't realize you were letting them pull up onto the property. Like,
we haven't
okay.
stopped them.
That's
the
different
problem
situation.
No, that's the problem I see, because it looks like a driveway. I can imagine that a lot of people are just pulling right up there.
Yeah,
there's actually three driveways right now on the property. That one, there's your main driveway where you have your right. driveway that goes back to the parking,
and then
there's another
garage,
that's no longer being used. That one, I'm recommending that you take that out and put curb in there so you can open it up for on-street parking.
Okay.
That, otherwise, you're not allowed to park in front of a driveway.
Okay.
So you can get ticketed there.
Yeah.
And that would be a decent on-street parking for you.
Okay.
So that would be the right thing to do.
Yeah. If we're doing it, we'll do it all. And actually, that would be a good excuse to maybe even just remove that, because it is more of a headache than it's worth if we're going to do all the other
Well as far as the driveway up
yeah.
above, yeah, it's already being removed, and that's going to be landscaped
right.
with the amended soils.
Yep.
So that's part of the storm.
No, that's part of what's going
on. Yeah.
Perfect.
Oh, yeah.
Good.
So Michael already Thanks. Thought of that.
Okay, good.
Okay. If there are no more questions from any of staff or commission members, is there anyone from the general public who wants to comment on this particular project? Okay, hearing none, we've heard reports and comments from staff and public works. I ask the commission for a vote on action for the request for preliminary final for the Humane Society of Berks County.
We've had discussions about this before, but back in the day, we used to do it this way, so I'm going to do it this way. I place a motion on the floor that we table the preliminary final plan for the Humane Society of Berks County at the property known as 1801 North 11th Street.
Okay, motion's been made to table. Is there a second? Okay, any discussion? Okay, hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to table the preliminary and final approval of Humane Society of Berks County. Those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you for your
okay,
clarification and consideration. Have a good evening.
Okay, next in the docket is the preliminary final plan for the Greater Berks Development Fund regarding proposed land development of a parcel at 490 Temple Hawkins Street for a proposed 20,000 square foot manufacturing and commercial development. It supported loading dock spaces and parking prepared by the Great Berks Development Fund.
Hi, good evening. Nice to see everybody.
All right, sir.
I received Tim's comment letter and Adam's draft agenda for tonight, and also David's zoning letter. So wherever you'd like to start, happy to help and chime in.
Tim, why don't you on the record public works?
Okay. All right. few items here were discussed at our meeting with Mr. Bozier earlier in the month and kind of left over from the last time that was presented. At the top of the list is the issue of zoning ordinance 600-907, which requires that this subdivision establish a private street or private road, which is currently known as Gateway Drive, but to which Public Works has not been able to find any evidence that this is actually a legal private street. And so this is the concern, not only for this lot, but mainly for lot one, which is a landlocked lot, without there being some type of legal frontage. The ordinance requires that all lots be appropriately located with sufficient frontage on a public right-of-way or a private street if it meets the acceptance of zoning and Public Works. And as I said, that we have not been able to find any legal or legitimate standing to make this a private street. So that's the first thing on the agenda. So I'll throw that out there for discussion, and then we can talk about utilities and accessibility.
Well, for me, I looked at it, and I really, what got presented was really comments 1, 2, 3, and 5. Those comments basically looked at probably how the Sunridge and the Hydrojet parcels were put together 12, 13 years ago. And our applicant tonight can certainly give a goodwill effort to address them, and if successful, can try to get towards compliance of what's in the letter. If those property owners are willing to go ahead and work with what's being requested, Greater Berks is certainly satisfied. If we could even make it a public street, they would probably even make that effort as well. But that's going to require some legal and other concerns that we could really address at final plan. So I'd really rather just defer that to that point for those four items, because that's going to require legal work that's already been previously accepted by the city when those plans were approved. So again, my applicant will make a good faith effort. And if you would like to sit in, Tim, if there's meetings, you know, we're happy to invite you along. You know the group that I work with.
Yeah. I don't. Is there something about the request that would be objectionable? Or
it's not objectionable to my client, but I don't know what Mr. Rado from Hydrojet would say. I don't know what Sunridge from Vancouver will say. I worked with Mr. Neville Israel and Carl Svankton. I know Carl's no longer at Sunridge. I don't know all the players who put it there are mm-hmm. still there today. So I don't know who I'm going to be working with. But again, I'll make the good faith effort to try to get it done for what's being requested. But they're their own property owners, and I can't force them to do something different.
Then the option would be they don't cooperate. In that case, you know, Public Works would not recommend even preliminary plan approval if that were to stay the way it's presented on the plan currently.
Well,
because right now, lot three only owns half of the access to that lot. You'd have to drive on the left half of the road, which would be the wrong way to get in.
I don't agree. The notes were on the plans previously that allowed the design to go forward the way that it's shown. And that was what was requested from the Planning Commission and the planner at the time.
Yeah.
I can't speak to history,
but I don't agree with that. I understand,
and we're willing to try to get it to a better situation. And it would invite you if you'd like to be part of it.
I'm going back to it. I mean, I don't want to get into the history of it, but just for the record, I'll just say the history. It won't change the opinion of this from Public Works. But in 2006, Charlie Jones, who was then the Public Works Director, comment number one on the Sunridge plan stated that something about an access and utility easement and all on-site utilities will remain private. Well, the access and utility easement is not shown on either not what I could see on the Sunridge plan or on this plan. So was there, what is this access and utility easement that Mr. Jones was referring to?
I believe that was the one that was prepared back in the time frame, and I think I got you a copy, where it went up and it almost looked a little bit more like a golf club head at the end for the turnaround and like the utility easement that he had. He had signed it, but I don't believe the attorneys facilitated it at that time. I'm going to do the best I can to get it.
I don't deny that the plan got recorded, but it got recorded without establishing, in my mind, and I reviewed this with Ralph Johnson, and he agrees with me that this does not appear to have adequate backing as far as substantial indication that this is a private street. So, and I don't think I would recommend even planning commission to make a preliminary plan approval, because you also need access for the utilities, and I'm mainly concerned about the sewer, the sanitary sewer. I did talk to Rawa about their water line.
Yep.
And they seem to be happy. They indicated that they do have an access easement, and theirs is a loop that loops onto a good portion of Lot 3 and Lot 1 and then down Gateway Drive. That they actually own the pipe, so it was deeded over to them, and they have access. Now, that access easement's not shown on the plan either, but they seem to be happy with it, so.
Yeah, we've worked with Rawa, and we've
That's what we're looking for.
their comments as well, so. Yeah. We try to work with everybody as they present the comments that they have.
That would sort of summarize my concern of the second item, which is the sanitary sewer easement. The third item I had, well, there's two more, actually. One is the access. Since the lot is private, it does border a minor arterial street, which is Buttonwood, and the ordinance requires that there be accessibility from that sidewalk. So we're going to be looking for the accessible path that would meet, as far as it's practical, meet the requirements of the U.S. Access Board for ADA accessibility.
We'll provide a sidewalk on the Lot 3 side from Buttonwood Street to roughly the front door or somewhere in that area.
Okay. All right.
That was on yours and David's.
Okay, right.
That was really the only outstanding zoning item that we had, and I recommended compliance to.
He mentioned that, yes. Okay, good.
Tim, do you have any more items?
Just the one other comment, and I think you're aware of this from the stormwater end. We're not requesting or requiring that anything be dedicated or turned over for stormwater, just that the fact that this owner understands that if there's an illicit discharge into the MS4, the city's MS4, which is our storm main out in Buttonwood Street, that the owner of that pipe will be held responsible for whatever discharge comes through it, whether they're the generator or not. So take that into consideration with this maintenance agreement that we're referring to. Just a word of the wise.
I saw what you were looking for.
Okay.
I understood. And again, that's why I said that, you know, attorney's going to have to be involved to really address several of your comments.
And I did this myself, attorneys were involved.
So, you know, I've already requested that Mr. Yoder become involved to address your commentary.
Okay.
Where the results are going to take us, I'm really not quite sure. So, you know, again, I would request preliminary plan. Give me some time to work through it with you.
Yeah.
Because the site is the site. I'm going to be back in front of you 100 times. You know, I'm going to try to get it the right way for you.
Yeah, very good.
Just a question on the street. I had asked about whether it were a public street, and among my concerns was about the sidewalk and all that. But if you could just enlighten us as to what the legal difference is between a private street and a public street. I've never heard that term here before.
Yeah, there is a difference. I'm not an attorney, but my experience is in doing these for other industrial parks myself when I was doing this privately, is that you do need an agreement and you do need an easement on a fixed area, like a lot description. I mean, you can do it with meets and bounds. I guess there may be other ways to do it, but I always did it with meets and bounds, and then it was a legal agreement signed by all parties that would be transferable to the heirs of those future owners of those properties, not just the property owners that happen to sign the plan. It would have to be transferable.
So it would still be privately owned, but there would still be, besides sidewalk and all that, it would still be all the usual traffic.
Yes.
Rules that would apply.
Everything else would apply. They would have to do the maintenance, and I believe they are. I checked with our guys, and we don't plow it, we don't maintain it. That's all being done currently by the owners, so hopefully they wouldn't mind putting that in writing.
Tim, what is the reuse for this site?
The reuse?
The intended use.
Industrial. It's a 20,000 square foot industrial use. I haven't heard anything definitively other than that.
Well, who is the intended owner of the development?
Intended owner? I don't know if there is an intended one. There's a current owner.
The owner is intended to be Greater Berks Development Fund at this time under that plan to a possible leasee that was a medical industrial type tenant.
Good manufacturing.
Medical manufacturing. And, you know, like I told you, if it doesn't meet the zoning exactly, then they'll come back and they're required to gain that acceptance with you.
Any comments from planning staff? So history tells us that the site divided into three parcels was first occupied by Sun Fresh or Sun Rich.
Sun Rich.
And then Hydrojet. Now we have this third parcel.
Right.
And it sounds like the history of it is that whatever approvals were given don't meet the approval requirements of today.
For a private street. It appears to me that way, yes. Okay. Yeah. And Ralph, and I think the rest of the staff has reviewed it too, and I think we're all in agreement on that.
So, there's a difference of opinion.
Well, I don't know that there's a difference of opinion. Greg,
Is
there a difference?
We're not on the same page. I mean, I understand where you're at. I understand you want to get it current to today with the way you look at things, as opposed to the way somebody looked at it, you know, 10 years before you.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate that. I like seeing things my way as well as many times as possible. But this was also approved and accepted and recorded. So again, we'll do the best we can, but if we can't do our best, I'm also trying to tell you that I can't commit to comments 1, 2, 3, and 5.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, it could become a different creature. I'm hoping that doesn't happen.
Have they been approached yet, the owners?
No, that's why I was trying. We got the comment letter yesterday
right. For
your opinion of where you stood.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Although we did talk about this earlier, too.
I know we talked about it. I tried to get you all the documentation that I would hope that this wasn't going to occur.
Yeah, and I tried doing my research, too. Yeah, I know we were doing research.
So, you know, I have to give you the benefit of the time and to do what it is you'd like to do. I'm not saying that. I'm still hopeful we're going to wind up on the same page.
Yeah, just to let the commission know, we have a private, quote, private street called Spuler Drive. It's out by Eggleman's Park. It's on the map. It looks like a legitimate street, and there's 4 or 5 homes that front on it. And yet, it's not a dedicated street. It's not even a private street. It's barely a driveway because one of the owners decided to put some pavement down there, and it has been nothing but a pain for the public works, because we get phone calls about this, that people are running down my property, you know, digging up and causing noise and having parties, and it is just a perennial problem because it was never established as a road, private or public. And it's really important to establish these during the planning process. It's unfortunate that it didn't get developed well enough back in 2006 when this was first proposed. It got kicked down the road. Maybe promises were made that it would be happening later on or something, but this is the last chance. I mean, this is the final lot, so.
And I'm just
needs to happen.
I can speak with Public Works Director Rob Johnson, and we can have discussions, and certainly we'll sit down with the applicant. I think it's important to know what happened. And if we unearth that, the previous approvals did not include the approval for a private street correctly, then it's important to correct that error. I mean, erratas happen, as you know, and that doesn't excuse, in my opinion, moving forward just because something was missed in the past. That is my concern. If the regulation for private streets states what it states, regardless of what's happened in the past, it should be corrected now.
I do hear you. I do understand you. We will try to make that happen.
Sure, and we will work with you on
it. But if it becomes outside of our control,
right, then we'll have to have other
then
discussions.
Then we're going to have to take a different approach, hopefully together.
We will have
because
to look at alternatives.
I can't promise you that we can actually deliver what you have asked.
I can't imagine Mr. Rado, who I believe owns lot the Hydrojet lot. I don't know if he's the owner.
He still is the owner of the Hydrojet lot. Yes, sir.
Because what's at risk, and he may not be aware of this, if this is not considered illegal, if it goes to court and somebody other than an engineer makes this determination, they decide that, and agree with me that this is not a private street, he has an illegal lot. He's got a liability on his hands.
No.
This is more to his advantage. Yeah, it's a landlocked lot.
Okay.
Well, and it has no frontage on any legitimate road.
What happens if somebody would deem it to be landlocked is they would go to court. It would be determined that this would be their path in and out, and they would be granted that path in and out by a judge.
Maybe, but that would be contrary to zoning 600-907. That would not agree with 907, because it would have to be considered either a public right-of-way or a private street that meets the conditions of 907, and it doesn't. So I don't know why a judge would make that decision. So I think Mike Rado doesn't realize that.
Just table the discussion and recommend that Planning Commission per decision so that we can have discussions with the applicant.
Okay. Any comment from the public on this particular project? Hearing none, you have all heard Public Works and Planning Staff's comments and the Commission's comments. I'll entertain a motion to pass judgment on the applicant's request for preliminary final for this project.
On motion to table the preliminary final plan for Greater Berks Development Fund at the parcel known at 490 Topolobin Street.
The second motion, Mr. Chairman.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion. Greg, when you said earlier that the plan had been, or the parcel had been reviewed, approved, and recorded, was that just for parcel 3 or the whole subdivision?
It was approved at one time for the whole property when it was American Chain and Cable.
Uh-huh.
Then it was approved for Sunridge with the additional strip going up all the way. Hydrojet came in second. That was also approved. And again, this is the third lot. And presumably, it'll be the third approval, and this industrial subdivision would be complete.
Okay. You know who the civil site engineer record was for those?
It was me each time.
Okay.
That's why I had all the history. I had all the history that I provided on the notes and the plans. It was done per notes, which has been accepted in the past. I understand, you know, today we use meets and bounds all the time for easements and how things get described. That wasn't what that applicant wanted to do at the time, and that's the way it furthered itself on this plan.
Okay, any other discussion? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion that, well, I'm sorry, let's vote on the motion. It's been moved and seconded that the submission for preliminary final for Gateway 3 be tabled. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
Have a good night.
Thanks, Greg.
Thank you.
Next is preliminary final plan review approval for 253 Reed Street regarding the proposed land development of a parcel. The purposes of constructing a 27-spot parking lot prepared by Berks Surveying and Engineering on behalf of Mr. Van Ponce.
know you guys are going to pick this apart, so I'm just basically here tonight to hear your input and whatever needs to be changed. I'm sure the engineer will change it all, and hopefully we come back in here next month and we get to actually do something instead of talking about it.
Jim, can you give the Public Works report, please?
Yeah, I don't have anything in writing on this one, although the staff had a chance to go through this, and I've had a chance to look over it fairly in depth, not totally in depth, but it looks like a pretty good plan. What I'm not seeing is stormwater management that would meet this. I mean, this lot here would exceed anything that this body would normally consider as de minimis, even though there is no de minimis in stormwater management, but it's being received as a land development plan and therefore needs to comply with the stormwater management ordinance, which your engineer is familiar with. So if he has any questions and wants to talk to me about it, go over some details, I'd be happy to answer them.
What is your name, sir?
Yeah, my name is Tim Krall, K-R-A-L-L. I'm with the City Public Works.
Yeah, he was aware of that. We knew that that was going to be an issue. He just said, go in, do what you got to do, and then when let us know what we need to meet the requirements, and then it'll change everything up. So when we get in here next month, everything's good to go.
That's it for Public Works.
Pardon me, sir?
That's all for Public Works.
Okay. Does planning have any comments on this application?
As of this point, according to zoning, it's met everything that we've, the lighting and photometric plan was one of our concerns. We're still in discussion with the arborist. He's approved the plan as drawn I'm not even going to attempt to pronounce the name of that tree.
I have an issue with that. I own a tree company. I've owned a tree company for 31 years.
Okay.
I plan on putting ornamental plums in there. They don't fruit. They only get about 15 feet tall, and they're very easy to manage.
And that's what that tree was?
I don't know what he said it was, but that's kind of what I'm thinking of putting in there, just because I know it fits nice in that space.
It says flowering plum.
What's that?
It says flowering plum.
It does there?
Yeah.
Is that what the even. Prunus, you're going to force me to say it?
I forget where it is on the plan.
My wife can say this. Sarah?
Seraphia?
Seraphia?
Flowering plum.
Flowering plum.
Okay. Well, then you're fine.
Okay, well, yeah, maybe I made a comment on that before, so maybe that's where we are with that.
Yeah, and it would seem to me that the green areas underneath the tree would be enough that the debris from the trees when they shed their fruit will not get on the.
There's no fruit to the plum trees.
Yeah, they're not.
I missed that. Okay, very good.
The only other thing, and I've been in contact with your engineer, there were some minor issues with the city requirement. They have my review sheet. So that when you come back for the final, they should be addressed. We'll take a look at those.
They already know that then?
Yeah.
Okay.
I actually could add one more thing, Chairman. We did get an email from our city arborist who did review the Reed Street plan, and it says that I approve the proposed site plan presented as presented here. That's Lester Kissinger approved that. So he likes your flowering plum. Mm-hmm. It would have to pass his muster, so. Looks like he's good with it.
Okay. Yeah, that's not a problem.
Any comments from the Planning Commission members?
Well, just curious, I'm looking at an aerial photograph. It looks like there's diagonal parking on the Elm Street side, but that's still, I don't know, because I'm not sure where the driveway would be.
There's an existing driveway already there on the Reed Street side. See where that.
They're on the Elm Street side, it looks like.
On the Reed Street side. See where the white car is there on the right picture? Going too fast.
That's actually the driveway there.
Yeah, see where that railing is?
Yes.
That's where the driveway is. There's already an apron there. Mm-hmm. I had to put those blocks there because I had people parking illegally, and then I got a letter from the city, so I had to put those blocks there for that reason.
So there'll only be one driveway?
Yep.
Is that how, that's all right for us? So it wouldn't affect those street parking?
The only question I have about the street parking is, because I have other parking lots in the city, and I know there's supposed to be a 10-foot yellow curb on every entrance. Now, on that Reed Street entranceway, the house that's abandoned in front of me has a blue curb, a handicap curb. So I don't know if that's going to play into effect in the near future. And then on the other side of Elm Street, it's a dead end, which, by the way, Public Works never cleans.
Yeah, if there's a problem, you can always call it in.
I have.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I've taken photos into the sweet street sweeper and everything.
Have you done an eye request?
Have I done what?
Eye request.
On the computer?
Is it, well, yeah.
I don't do a computer, I do a person.
Okay. Yeah.
If you call in the community service center, they'll put it on the computer. What that does is that makes a work order.
Exactly.
I've been to the Public Works place. I've been to City Council on not just this, but numerous other things throughout the city. I had the mayor call me all kinds of names, the city work director. I got kicked out of the parking authority, all for stuff that I presented to them that they don't want to hear.
Right. That being said, I would encourage you to put in the request. If you don't have eye requests on your computer or phone, walk into citizen service, just give them a photo of the incident and leave it.
With all due respect, everything I've ever done in the last 4 years trying to deal with the city, nothing's ever been addressed, ever.
Okay, I'm here to change that.
When?
Okay. Today. Submit the request tomorrow, and I will follow up.
All right, okay. We'll see.
Actually, at the end of that street, it's marked as private on the plan, so the city would have no reason to clean up the end of that street. It's marked as a private alleyway.
Okay. Okay. You're talking about Elm Street, though.
I'm talking about Elm Street.
Yeah, not the alley.
And the see, this is marked private here.
Well, that would be because that's still part of the alley.
Yeah.
The street ends at the dashed line.
Right. The other problem there is that the adjoiner there is Norfolk Southern, I believe.
Yeah.
Right. Norfolk Southern gets to do whatever they want to do because they're a Class A utility.
Yeah.
I know. So, the city has no control over what they do or how they clean things. Mm-hmm. Okay. Just pointing that out to you.
Okay. I kind of knew that.
Excuse me. Any further questions from the commission?
I have a list.
You have a list?
I have a list.
Okay.
Okay. First, on the corner there of Reed and Elm Street, I believe that's going to require a handicap ADA accessibility.
There's already one there.
I don't think so. I drove past it today. I didn't see it.
Yeah, but MedEd smashed it when they put the new pole in like a month ago. See the new pole that they put in there? See the double poles? Right in front of that double pole.
Okay.
I can see it on the right side.
All right.
It's something your engineer should look at.
Yeah.
Well, we're
because those poles are not supposed to be there.
I didn't put them there.
Well, you're going to have to get your engineer to say that they're in a public right of way. They got to be moved.
And just from looking at it, it looks like that ramp probably would not meet the current 2010 standards for ADA accessibility.
I'm planning on putting a whole new sidewalk in. If we're going to do this, we're going to do the whole thing.
Good.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
The other problem that I see is that I don't see any curbing on Elm Street on the plan. Is Public Works would Public Works require the curbing?
I have to take a look at that because it is a dead end street. I guess that would be something for the commission to talk about too. Is there a destination that would require sidewalk?
There's no destination.
I guess the biggest thing is there an inlet down there where the water would need to be directed? And it looks like there is.
I think I think there is, and it's filled in with dirt, apparently.
There's a sewer catch basin at the alleyway in the back mm-hmm. corner.
Yep.
There's no destination for pedestrians to go back there. I mean, it goes right into Conrail.
Yeah, I don't think the sidewalk is would be a question. I think curbing would be a question. And I think that's something that I think staff and Public Works would need to review. It could very well be that everything, when they tore down the building that was there, everything got busted up.
No, there's a big concrete slab right there. If you look in front of those cars that are parked the wrong way, there's just a big, huge, giant concrete slab there.
Oh, that's right. Those were loading docks.
Yes.
That's right. Those were loading docks.
You can see the sidewalk goes so far and then stops into a big concrete slab. There's no curbing there, so those people decided to park the way any way they want to.
And for those who don't remember, this was the Reading cold storage building that the city tore down a number of years ago.
Thank you for my time.
Am I seeing it correctly on the plan that there is a landscaping area along Reed Street?
Down the corner, Reed and Elm.
Just along Reed Street there.
Are you talking about this here section here?
Yeah, it says proposed landscape area.
I don't know what that is.
Okay.
Put that in there.
Generally, just in case, if the place across the street, which looks like it's on the blighted property list, according to the signage on the building. Just in case that becomes residential for some strange reason, it would be that land, that strip would be required to be, what is it, Ermini? At least 4 feet high?
The buffer?
Yeah, the buffer, so that headlights don't cast into the neighboring building.
Which side are you talking about? The Elm Street side or the
Reed Street?
Reed Street side.
I don't think I would worry about the Elm Street side, especially since there's no there's no landscape area put there. I think we can, although I think in the ordinance it's required, but I think we can give you a waiver considering what's across the street.
Well, across the street on Elm Street side is a building that's ready to fall into my parking lot.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If that building is removed and that becomes residential, that's going to require a landscaping strip, which is shown here on the plan.
We'll have to take a look at that because that.
I
think you're referring to the 5'9" strip along the sidewalk.
Yeah.
Along Reed
this,
Street.
This area here.
It's proposed landscape area, although
I'm talking
this
about
is.
This part.
Yeah, that's in the right of way. So we wouldn't want to put any trees that wouldn't be considered shade tree in that area, because then that requires maintenance by Public Works. That's not private, that's public.
Oh, right.
So if there's going to be a buffer, it would have to be on the private side.
Yeah.
Right now they're not showing any mm-hmm. buffer on the private
Probably
side.
Probably because this is listed as a commercial building.
Right. Could be.
And I think the ordinance says it needs to be there for residential. So that might need to be something that's looked into. I think somebody mentioned that you're going to need a separate plan sheet for your lighting plan.
Yeah, I just put that on a note here.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here, I talked about the landscaping strip. On your zoning hearing board, appeal, which you were granted, items 7B through 7F. I don't know why the zoning hearing board does this, but they say this stuff's up to the zoning administrator. Yes, it is up to the zoning administrator, but also all of these items must be shown on the plan.
Okay.
So, lighting plan, we already talked about that. Height and type of proposed fence. Height and length of the proposed wall along the alley. Two parking spaces in the... Oh, revised plan showing dimensions of the two parking spaces, which I think that's been done already. And a revised plan depicting the ADA parking space dimensions, and that looks like that's been done. So it just is the fence and the wall dimensions. Need to be shown as a detail on a plan sheet.
Well, the fence is there.
Or as a note.
It says 6-foot chain link fence right there on the plans.
You might be able to see that. Yeah. It does say 6-inch chain link, 4-foot chain link.
Yeah, but there's no details on the proposed masonry wall.
Oh, okay.
So the details on the proposed masonry wall need to be at least shown in a plan.
Speaking of my engineer, he didn't put that in because he wasn't sure what you guys were going to require. I had said something about those blocks that I had there, maybe building something out of that. But he didn't put that in, and we knew that we were waiting to hear what are you guys going to require there, whether it be a poured concrete wall or a landscape block wall. We knew that, but we were waiting to hear from what you guys are.
Okay, makes sense. Does Public Works have any?
I'm not sure what would be the purpose of the wall.
To level off.
So to act as a retaining wall?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I'm not seeing a whole lot of, maybe right down in the corner there? Is there a grade change?
Do you saw those pictures? There was part of a wall there from, right there, you can see it. You see part of that wall there?
Yeah.
That comes on a slope? That's, I guess, from
it
the
has like
factory.
That slope yet. That comes down?
Right.
Oh, okay.
Basically
from
there to the corner and around to the loading dock would be a wall.
I can't quite see it from the grading plan, the contour, but I can see it from that picture.
Right. That's why I said that we weren't sure if you guys were going to require a concrete poured wall or if those blocks would be sufficient. Because I see a lot of people do the landscape block walls.
Yeah, if it's a landscape block wall, I mean, the engineer knows how to design it, puts the detail on there.
And that's why it's not on here.
There's nothing special for Public Works as long as it's engineered and they'll seal your plans.
Right.
We'll be fine with it.
We can't tell you what to do. We can only ask you to make it work and hold back the hurt.
Yeah.
I can do that.
You made reference to a property that is blighted, which I'm looking at the site plan.
It's on the Elm Street side.
Yeah, let me see here.
It is the whole front's ready to fall off of.
Yeah, I passed by there today, in fact.
And it's blacker. It is.
Is that this one?
Yeah,
it does have a.
It's a half a block long.
Yeah it's. And it is, yeah, it's...
There's no roof to it anymore.
That's the one without the roof.
You
that
back
slated
up
to
one,
become
one shot.
I just wanted to add...
Yeah, building and trades is scheduled.
It's this property right here.
Okay.
All the way down here, right. I believe. This is, and it's in structurally poor condition.
That one there is bad too, but the other one's even worse. They're both on both sides, and then the one that the house that's adjacent to me is also on the blight. I'm surrounded by blight for the most part.
Vehicles on it that are going to have difficulty coming in and out of Reed Street.
You're opening up a can of worms here.
That's, yeah. But I,
I've met you before, sir, and I know that I've kind of figured that's, but I thought I should bring that up.
We're renting it.
What your intent is.
We're renting it to relieve parking. My father owns a shop, a garage right down the street, and the taxi cab company has also shown interest in possibly renting parking to get Reed Street. Because Reed Street's a nightmare. I don't know if you've ever gone through there during the day. I also had some, I guess it's Penn State Berks now. They showed some interest in possibly renting some spaces too for the nurses or doctors or whoever.
Any more questions from commission members?
That's it for me.
This one. Okay, so in further to someone, Commissioner Taylor's question, so we don't have to decide this tonight if we're going to table, but so we could, in theory, waive the sidewalk requirement, but without waiving the curb requirement. Is that right? We'd sort of.
That's correct.
Parts of the same provision, but we could do one without the other, in theory.
In theory, yeah.
Okay, so we'll have to get some guidance on that in the meantime. Because heretofore, we've already done it together.
Yeah, it'll probably be best if Tim or someone from Public Works gets out there.
I understand where you're going.
Looks at the detail. Yeah. Just so, it's all about stormwater flow.
And the parking. You've got the diagonal parking, and right. You've got the topographic plan, which requires curbing. We don't like eliminating curbs. That's how the city's laid out. It's laid out on curbs.
Curbs are one thing I was, because I agree, there's no, who's going to be walking there, but, you know, so I don't see that. But I don't remember if it's been down.
Yeah.
Back to dead end
there,
so.
I agree.
Okay, well, we'll look for advice on the curbs then.
All right, if there's no more questions from any of the commissioners, any public input, comments on this project? Seeing none, hearing none, I will entertain a motion to decide on the request for preliminary final plan review of 253 B Street.
I'll move to the table. The preliminary final plan for 253 Reed Street.
Okay, it's been moved. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Any discussion?
I'd like to say something.
Sorry?
I'd like to say something.
Us, please.
All right, so what I'm going to tell you guys is I have several properties throughout the city who are all in codes and very well maintained. I've been dealing with this city I've actually kind of stepped up and gotten Bob for the last 4 years, and they've done nothing for me other than give me a hard time. Even when I took their own legal documents to them, they still have not done nothing. I want to do this by the law. I want to do this correctly, because that's the way you're supposed to do things. I'm not asking for any favors from left or right, don't matter. I just want to not have to be here August, September, December. I want to move forward with this plan and get it done. Take a crappy property and make something nice out of it. I understand you guys have a job to do, and I'm willing to work with you guys and do all that. But if I get kicked down the road and get kicked down the road, I'm just going to open up with ouches. I already have this here file right here. It is a file that is I have on a property that has been operating for 4 years, has never paid taxes, has no business license, has nothing. And the city's done nothing. And I've made them more than aware of it. So all I'm saying is I want to do it right, but I don't want to get beat up on the process of it. Let's get it done. You tell me what you need, we get it done, and it's done. If not, I'm going to just open up without you, and we'll fight it out from there.
Well, I thank you for your frankness and your honesty. You did say one thing that is very true. We're following the rules, we're doing what have been given to us as what we're supposed to do. We want to make sure that what gets done properly, that you're covered, you're correct, and the only thing I see happening is that Berks Engineering makes these minor modifications to your plan. There's nothing that I'm seeing that says we can't give you final approval in August. I understand being an architect and being on that side of the table, I've been through this process more times than I care to admit, and I've lost projects because of it. So
I share your concern. We're going to try and get it done as efficiently as legally as possible.
That's all I'm asking for.
That's all we can do, sir.
Okay.
I'm sorry that you had to go through it, but welcome to our world.
Yeah, I know. And I plan on buying and doing some other things in the city. I mean, I live in the city. But dealing with some of these situations in the city and different departments, it's not pleasant in any way.
And you're not alone.
Oh, I know I am.
You're not alone.
I know.
I have made 2 requests personally for projects in the city that I've been a part of for Freedom of Information Act. I've been stonewalled by the legal department.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have the time, effort, and energy or the deep pockets to file a lawsuit against the city for information that is rightly mine.
Well,
so
just,
I share that only because even from this side of the table, we have issues.
Just to let you know, I don't have deep pockets either. But if I feel like I'm getting stepped on, I'll sell something because I will not back down on point. That's just how I am.
Well, we're here to make it easier for you, believe me.
All right.
I would not ask these gentlemen and ladies to be here if we didn't think we're making a difference, so we're trying.
I understand. And I've been patient and I've been trying to deal with it because what's going on, and I mean, this is just one property I have identified. I have several others at home in a file.
We need your investment savvy. We need people like you, so we don't want to send you away.
Good.
Our salvo process is incomplete. Our municipal planning code is incomplete. That being polite, it doesn't address a lot of these issues. It alludes to and all other issues. But when we try to address the other issues, we're told you can't do that.
I already know that, and that's why I'm telling you, if we can't work this out and get this project moving, I know you guys really don't have a lot of power to stand on. I already know that.
Through the whole state.
Right.
It's all the same.
Well, we can try and raise hell, but it'll have to be done diplomatically.
Yeah.
Because we'll lose our jobs.
And because I have documentation that you guys didn't take action through so many years, therefore I have those so many years to operate. I know this particular property here, the man has operated for 4 years that I know of, and he's only ever paid a $500 fine. He's never paid tax or anything. I'll operate for 4 years and only pay $500. No problem. It's a great business move. Mm-hmm.
We'll see you next month for the last time on this project.
I hope so.
Thank you.
Sorry,
we have to vote.
We didn't vote.
Yet.
We still got to vote.
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. Thank you. Any more discussion? All those in favor of tabling this motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The motion is tabled for 1 month.
Okay, thank you. See you guys next month.
Is this Reed Street parallel to the railroad property?
Yes. Is the Reed Street property
parallel to the railroad property?
I believe that
yes.
Yes.
Yes, it's in between Reed Street and the railroad property. And what complicates the situation is that there's a 15-foot private alley in the back, and that's probably where most of the trash is. Problem is coming from. Besides that, as I mentioned, that's Conrail property.
Mm-hmm.
City.
Well, the alley is not. It borders it.
Yeah.
The alley is in the city, and then Conrail, or not Conrail, but Norfolk Center Road is right up against it.
But still, it being private, how much control does the city have of it?
And correct.
It's not much.
None.
Okay, our last project to be reviewed. The waiver request is just going to hold our call regarding the proposed land development. 1601 North 13th Street. They're proposed to expand the existing library facilities to include a 4-story elevator, stairwell tower, the pedestrian, and an adjacent 2,000 square foot exterior home surface being presented to us down by David Seck.
David, how are you?
Good.
Good to see you.
Thank you. I appreciate your attention tonight. I do have a flash drive with some pretty pictures of renderings and things like that that have developed.
Well,
if you
want to
throw it up there.
There you go.
Good catch. The project has been advancing. We've been studying the architecture, and there's some renderings of what the tower will look like.
There's one in the back, too.
There's one in the back?
Yep.
I'm going to make a comment about city equipment later.
I would have never looked there. Nothing.
I fix them for a living.
I know.
I do have hard copies if the technology doesn't work out.
That's not a bad idea. Since this is a sketch plan, Tim, I'm assuming you don't have any review.
This isn't even a, pardon me. This is not even a sketch plan. This is just a waiver request.
Oh, okay, excuse me.
So with the size of the tower addition, the footprint, on the application, the footprint was called out as 1,300 square feet. We've even made it a little bit tighter. It's down to under 1,200 square feet, about 1,150. The whole concept for the proposed addition is to get vertical circulation through an elevator that serves all floors of the building. Currently, the elevator doesn't serve the top floor of the library. There is also a shortage of restrooms in the facility, so we're adding, and they're currently not accessible at all, so we're adding accessible restrooms. And then there's a stair, circulating stair that connects all the floors together. And this will serve as the new entrance to the building. Over time, the college intends to renovate the interior of the building, but this is the first phase of the project. Adam, that's a USB 3.
Oh, we have it. There's something weird going on here.
All USB 3s are 2.0 compatible.
They were backwards compatible.
Not okay. Yeah, good.
There you go. All right. So the, lost it.
Yeah.
Doing a slideshow.
So this is a photo of the existing library. The building was originally built in 62 and was three stories and a basement. In 73, they added the top story. The top three stories of the building currently are library spaces. The ground floor is administrative uses. The president's office, provost, academic learning center is in that. The ultimate goal of the college is to renovate the entire building, interior and exterior, to accommodate the library and learning commons, they're calling it, which is a student support learning environment, tutoring, writing centers, academic support. The immediate goal is to build the tower that you see, the predominant elevation there on the right, left-hand side of the photo. The facade of the balance of the building, which is currently very square building, 100 feet square, ultimately will be renewed and replaced. We're having some failures of the brick veneer and the precast elements of the existing building. So it is overdue for rejuvenation.
Was this the original Centerbrook?
Centerbrook is the current architect that has prepared this. Okay. I'm acting as the owner's representative for the college. Okay. I'm not the architect of record.
Okay. All right.
So I've been working with the college for over a decade now on various projects, doing some architectural for small projects, but then supporting them as an owner's rep to shepherd the projects through all the different facets. Earlier this year, I submitted the project to zoning and received approval from the zoning board, or not the zoning board, but the zoning officials, that it did not need any variance or waivers. The addition is not going to add any more staff. It is purely circulation and restrooms. So they waived any requirement for additional parking. And we're well below the impervious surfaces necessitated for the campus center property. So if you go to the next slide, you'll see kind of there's the composite of all the different buildings in the center core of campus, which is surrounded by 13th Street, Union, Burn, and Palm Street. The library is the square building in the middle. The addition at that time was estimated to be about 1,300 square feet. We've tightened it down to under 1,200 square feet, just in refinement of the architectural. As I was saying, the entry, maybe jump to the next slide. I shifted this because the next photo is an aerial photo. The north in this plan is up. The addition is going to the east. And there's currently a large plaza off of the entry to the current library, which goes up the series of steps that are in the lower right-hand corner of the library building. That set of stairs, which takes you to the second floor of the building, will be eliminated ultimately, and the new entrance to the library will be at the ground level. So that plaza, that large plaza area that has the rectangles in it that are landscaped rectangles, and it has the kind of arched ends at either end, that is all concrete pavers now. That will ultimately be removed, and the grade will be tapered down to the planned first story entry. If you jump to the next photo, you can see that plaza much clearer here. And that white block is the set of stairs that go up to the library entrance currently. The green block is the proposed addition. The building that we're proposing is largely sitting on the existing sidewalk that is at along the whole east entrance, each east side of the building. So it's kind of sitting on currently impervious surface. The concept would be to create a plaza at that ground floor level to the east side. I think that shows up on the next slide. So you can see sketched in there off of the green block to the east is the proposed entry. We'd have a paved area immediately in front of the building. The concept would be to put in some concrete or stone walls as kind of sitting walls, retaining some of the grade that slopes down to it. And we would have an accessible walkway that goes up to the north and connects with the balance of the what they call Founders Walk, which is a combination of the main pedestrian thoroughfare as well as a fire lane. And then to the south and southeast would be sidewalk connections that reconnect to the other existing sidewalks. So that we're still developing the final site plan and landscaping, but that's the broader concept. The diagram to the left is the first floor plan, which shows the elevator, the stair, the main entry doors, and the proposed restrooms that will serve. Basically, the plan is the same on each floor, without the doors, obviously, but it basically becomes the circulation space to connect all the respective floors of the building together. The elevator will serve from the basement to the fourth floor now. So the, as I stated, the proposed addition, when I made the application, was about 1,300 square feet. It's down to under 1,200 square feet. The amount of impervious surface, I kind of took a estimation of about 2,000 square feet at that time, with the removal of the previous existing plaza, we're going to be less than what the impervious surface is today. So we're requesting, you know, a waiver to the full land development review and approval process. We will continue to engineer and landscape design the site around the proposed addition, but we request your waiver of all the full requirements.
Okay, thank you. Tim, I do understand you have some.
Actually, I've looked this over. I haven't really heard a whole explanation like Mr. Zell gave today. So I understand a lot more now than I did yesterday. Just some questions. For a waiver, one of the considerations is whether or not stormwater management ordinance would apply. The way you described it is the net new impervious area would be very small, if any.
If any, probably less than what it is currently.
That being true, then it would probably mean you would get an exemption or there wouldn't be any need for doing a drainage plan submission. The ordinance also, like the other submissions we had today, also applies to water quality, groundwater recharge, and storm bank, which has to do with the volume rather than the rate. We're not worried about the flooding. We're more concerned about cleaning the environment with the runoff from the new, not the net new, but the new impervious. So I'm seeing, I guess, what was 1320 is now 1150 or something, but it's over about 1,000 square feet of new roof area, footprint.
Building area, yes.
Building area, and then some proposed hard surface paving on top of that. In the past, this board has looked at that. We really have no de minimis area for water quality. It's whatever, it needs to be addressed. So I guess my question would be, aside of the fact of whether or not we're considering a waiver of this, is the college going to do anything about water quality from the runoff from the new building area? Is there going to be a rain garden or any kind of water treatment, stormwater treatment?
We can certainly consider that. There will be lawn areas surrounding this development. So the currently most of the flow, sheet flow, so to speak, runs to the north, and there are existing catch basins and things along the edge of the building, as well as the fire lane, Founders Walk. But we can certainly entertain creating, you know, swales or rain gardens adjacent or prior to those catch basins to pick up and filter some of that. The college is leaning towards more sustainable design.
Right. And that would I could right see you had fenestration in there. It looked like you're trying to go green on the building, so that looks good. That's what we'd be looking for as far as compliance with stormwater management. Whether or not this commission gets involved with the land development plan.
We certainly have a lot of engineering to do yet to bring the plan forward, so we can certainly implement some of those concepts.
Sounds good.
What's the time frame for the approval?
We're finally getting good momentum with the design. We have retained a construction manager who's preparing pricing currently. Our hope is if we can receive the waiver, that we would be in a position to potentially start this late this fall. So it's all up to budgeting and funding and things like that. So we're trying to get the cost number. The preliminary costs are higher than what we had hoped, so we're struggling a little bit. But if all falls together, then the concept would be to start late fall. There is currently a permit application into the trades office for replacement of a steam line that runs in front of the library and connects to Masters Hall, and that Masters Hall is the classroom building at the lower end of the sketch there. That steam line has been failing for a number of years, and all winter long it just blows steam. So we're replacing that, and the current steam line that goes into the library would go through the footprint of the addition. So we're rerouting that and coming into the library, existing library, in a different location at the same time, kind of getting that out of the way prior to proceeding with the addition. But Masters Hall has to be reheated by October, so that's anticipate that excavation and work on the steam line all underground to take place in the end of August.
Okay, any questions from any commission?
I have two. Since this is going to be, this is actually a question for Tim. Since this is going to be many more bathrooms added to this building, is it going to require new sewer modules?
Well, we ran into this question with Avernia too. That's a good question though. Does the proposed addition, does the administration anticipate an increase in the population, student population, because of this addition?
No, currently the population, student population fluctuates with each year or semester. Mm-hmm. The library is open to all the students and faculty. Mm-hmm.
Would you anticipate additional staff because of additional office space or anything like this?
No.
Okay.
In fact, we're moving some of the staff out ultimately. That's in the administrative level currently. Okay.
So it sounds like it's just ancillary to what's already existing.
Yeah. There are toilet rooms in the building, obviously, but they're 1960s, 70s vintage. They're not accessible. They're in the wrong places, so to speak.
And just because you're adding new toilets doesn't mean you're going to add new flow.
Correct.
And that's the way we look at it.
Yes.
If it's dormitories, if it's new offices with new staff, we see an increase in the population of the campus. But if it's not, and it doesn't sound like the way you described it,
absolutely,
you'd be increasing either. And if that's the case, then I don't see a proposal of an EDU. Would be good to get that. I mean, if this goes to a land development plan, it would be good to get that in writing, you know, to just establish it so there's a history there. So somebody would look back and say, well, how come you didn't get planning modules? Well, here's the reason why, and it's explained.
And as I presented this to zoning, they inquired about that staff changes or attic, and there, as you can see from the plan, there is no office space. It's, you know, lounge space, reading spaces, and kind of circulation space.
Any restaurant or food operation? Okay.
No Starbucks.
The college had explored that and decided that it was not desirable or appropriate to have in the library with all the collection. And the student center is half a block away.
Millersville and Shippingsburg both have a Starbucks in their libraries.
Different approach. way of thinking, as Albright says.
My other question would be about the fire access. That founder's walk was put in in the 90s?
Well, there was a 80s, 90s version, but this current Founders Walk was put in 2015. It's, you know, 20 feet wide, 22 feet wide with the cobblestone curbs, has large arcs and things that it's built to handle the biggest fire truck Reading has, so it'll...
I just don't know if Marshall Cyril Frost would look at this and want some changes to how that might curve into the library, because that is how the fire trucks access the middle of campus.
Yes.
That's a good point. My one is run by the fire marshal.
Certainly. We've had some preliminary conversations with them about the whole construction and the process. We will, ultimately the building will come up to a much higher level of code compliance than what the old building is grandfathered into today. So.
Have you been to One Stop?
We were to One Stop.
The fire marshal has seen it.
Yeah, and I've had maybe probably two conversations with them that, if you're aware, there's a waiver on the fire alarm system which you would like to have upgraded. We've asked them for time to do that so we can do the renovation at the same time. The building is not currently sprinklered. It will ultimately be sprinklered. So he's already laid down all those ground lines.
Have you considered when you replace the steam line between the library and this other hall that you use precast concrete vaulting so that you can drop your steam line in that? And then also, if you want to compare to the front parallel and also the residual heat that comes out of the insulation and so forth in the winter, helps to defrost the sidewalk on the top of it.
We're putting in a concrete vault around the valving and the point where it turns and goes to the respective buildings, but it's a direct burial steam line.
Not on the run.
Excuse me?
But not on the run.
No. So. That's a nice system, but it's expensive.
Yeah. Well,
so
go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Well, so we have a policy that we require land development for any building addition above 800 square feet. And I understand this is 1100 plus the footprint, although it's 1100 on each floor, right? So,
yes.
So I don't know if that matters, because I'm not sure how we define ours as the. In this case, it's over anyway, but I don't know if we divide it as the footprint or the total square footage. That's another interesting question about that.
I would think footprint.
Okay.
Yeah, I think
I think the
idea back then was footprint, just because of impervious surface.
Exactly. Right, that makes sense. So maybe something we should think about clarifying as a side note, but in any case, it's over that anyway. So is the school store no longer in this building? Is that in the student center? I mean, I think it used to be.
Yeah, the school store is in the student center, yes. It's not in the library.
And there used to be a lot more public access, I think, in this building. I mean, because, you know, people can research, but I think there were more facilities in here that I think had moved to the other.
Some time ago, yes.
Right. I mean, that's relevant because of the flow.
When I was a student at Albright, the bookstore was already in the student center.
Oh, it was already.
And that was in the 80s.
Yeah.
It's been that long since I've been in this. But there were more spaces on the first floor for other purposes. So, and that's about right when the student center was built in the 80s. So, the only thing I just wanted to add is, you know, Albright has a beautiful campus, and this building has always seemed out of place to me. So I just thought it was going to be a tower addition, so I'm pleasantly surprised to see, you know, a whole redo of the facade.
Yes, the whole facade needs to be redo.
I think, David, when you come back for the review and approval to look at the building, I think you need to bring the interior perspectives to show what the building is going to be transformed from into. That tells the whole story. It's quite a feat. Okay, any other questions for David from the board? Any questions from the public? Hearing none, we have heard from Public Works and Planning. I entertain a motion for the disposition of the waiver request at sketch plan level for the Auburn College Library Addition.
I'll make a motion to approve the waiver request for the Albright College proposed expansion of its library facilities.
Okay, it's been moved. Is there a second?
I second.
Was that you, Miller? Okay, Bob did. Okay. All right. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion to approve the waiver request for sketch plan for the Albright College Addition, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Opposed?
No.
No.
Okay, hand vote. Pay attention. All right, those in favor, myself. Okay, two yes. Three notes. Okay.
So what does that mean?
The waiver's not been granted, so you have to inform the board and it up on that.
Okay.
Okay. How would you word the one that I had in my plan?
Yes, they're all three of my daughters are working well and scattered around the country.
I do not remember the name.
It was probably Sheehan, who's up in Boston now.
Okay.
Working for Liberty Mutual, doing quite well.
Okay. I passed her building on that quite yesterday.
If I, Mr. Chair, I mean, you're only representing Auburn on this project, right? Or do you represent them on any other one?
I help them with just about all
the time. That's what I thought, but okay. I wasn't sure how broad the mandate was. Right. So just wondering if things going on with the field behind Shirk Stadium. We had approved, I don't know how long ago it's been.
That was the temporary practice field, yeah. not the temporary, but the practice field that was going to be turfed.
Right. And other sundry additions.
They've kind of shifted their focus, and we'll be back before this committee, certainly with the proposed track and field that they intend to put on the David Crystal property.
Which was my other thought, exactly.
We're in the design and conceptual phase of that, so it'll be a few months before we come to you with that.
Well, yeah, I appreciate it. I've seen that the grass strip was put in on the Exeter Street side, at least, on that. And kind of narrow, but it still has grass strip on it. And so I thought that was the first step. So thank you for the update.
All right, so we have to go for a full land development process, and we'll be back. Shane, okay. We'll be here.
Page 2, Commission's Liaison Report.
see here. Where do I start? Oh yeah, I have a list today. I got to find it. I'll start out with that I would like to mention about the Blight and Housing meeting last week and how well that went. Most of us were there, but people from the county and all over the place were there. Berks County Planning Commission was there. Lucy Cortez from Community First Fund that helps fund a number of projects in the city was there. So very, very good turnout for that. I noticed that the Dana South made it in the news again, that the city's thinking about buying this from the Redevelopment Authority. Of course, you know, what do we have a Redevelopment Authority if they're not selling anything? But the other thing there is, once again, I will bring it up, that I've brought up many times before, is that the that property should have had a Class A cleanup, Class A brownfields cleanup. And as far as I know, it did not, even though the former executive director of the Redevelopment Authority wanted to argue with me about that. So therefore, you know, we have this property there that has these great vistas of the Schuylkill River and the confluence. And if the city decides that that's will continue to be an industrial property, a great opportunity has been missed to make that into what the overlay district would like it to be, which would be development that would be commercial on the first floor with residential on the upper floors. And we could have a section of the city that not only overlooks the river, has market-based apartments, unlike what the Buttonwood Gateway would be. And we need the Buttonwood Gateway. I'm not saying we don't need the Buttonwood Gateway. But, you know, we have these marketable apartments with this great new, like, town center vibe. That would be the way to go. But because, once again, Greater Berks Development Fund probably didn't pay for the correct cleanup of that, the city might, if the city decides to go that route, that's going to be a heavy price tag. Something that should have been done by Greater Berks Development in the first place. But as we all know, they always want to take the cheap way out. So I just wanted to bring that to everyone's attention. And I also wanted to make the point that last time I did make a mistake that Will caught me on about trying to the property at Laurel and Fifth, with the parking lot there, and they need a PennDOT HOP. The reason I was giving this some thought today, and the reason that we do not give conditional approvals when there are outside agency dependencies like PennDOT is because the Planning Commission years ago decided that it would best to be consistent. We already cannot make any decisions without Berks County planning approval, or planning review, I should say.
Not Berks County planning approval, but Berks County
Conservation District.
And then we also have a memorandum of understanding with the Berks County Conservation District that we cannot make any approvals without their approval first. I think it is in our best interest to continue that policy, so that policy is consistent.
And that, I believe, is everything.
Okay, any comments to Wayne's report, observations?
The thing aside that you referred to, is that the one that you call the border?
That's the water site.
Okay. What, you know, another concern I have is the large deposit of fill that came from the, which building was it? I'm using my alphabet over there, ready to end building, last one.
You know, I believe it was the parking garage.
Yeah.
I believe it was the parking garage.
No, it actually was the end building. Yeah, it was the latest building. Yes, yeah. Not the old end, but the latest new addition.
Yeah, the new tower.
The new tower. Yes.
Okay.
Correct.
That all went to that site.
Yes.
In the back part towards the river, I'm guessing.
Yes.
That you wouldn't build on that because it'd be a question of how they prepared that soil. You know, rolling.
Somebody will have to do some engineering on that.
You'd have to store that.
Well, not necessarily, but they'd have to do some engineering to remediate it if it's unstable.
Piles in there, and you'd have to
get down. You should see what I'm doing on River Road. The Lincoln Street extension is even worse than that. It's an old quarry. That's what we're doing on the other side, the north end of this industrial park, to get the trucks through.
There's a Reading Hospital parking garage. That's on the quarry, where they quarried the stone to build a hospital. Well, okay. I had another question when I forgot it. Listen to this dynamic answer.
Mr.
Chair,
he's thinking
what,
that.
What,
oh, go ahead.
What is this? You said that the city wants acquisition of that land again? I thought they had regained it.
If I may?
Yeah, let's have, because all what I'm referring to is what's in the paper today.
And all I can speak to is what's in the paper.
Yeah, but it was originally that we wanted it, but Berks got it, okay?
Redevelopment Authority owns the property.
The redevelopment authority. Yeah, now. Yes. Now it does. Yes. But before that, originally, Berks got a hold of Berks Redevelopment got a hold of it, correct?
Correct.
All right. They laid it out. They put the infrastructure in, the pipes, the plumbing, the streets, the curbs, and that. They did all of that. And then they came back to us to divide the lots from, I don't know what it was, four or five large lots into smaller lots. Then they came back to us a third time, and they wanted more subdivision. Remember? So they divided up to maybe 70 or 80 or 100 parcels. So they have flexibility as they got developers in there. Somebody comes in and says, I want parcel 29 to 48. That's my piece of pie that will fit my name. Correct?
Correct.
That. All right. Then the city got it from Berks Development when they gave up trying to find developers for it. Correct?
The Redevelopment Authority got it.
Correct.
Redevelopment represents it, but they got it from the Berks Redevelopment.
Correct.
Correct? Around right so far. So now, saying Reading Redevelopment still owns it.
Yes.
Okay, that's good.
The City of Reading's private real estate company that they manage that owns the properties at 5th and Penn. They want to buy it.
Oh, they want to buy it from the redevelopment?
Development Authority.
Well, what purpose was it given?
There was, as far as I remember, there was no purpose given in the paper.
And as you are pointing out, because of this long checkered history, I don't think a lot of people on city council understand the rat's nest they're getting into.
And
especially since there are now agreements. There are now agreements with Northeast Elementary School. That all eventually fell through, but I don't know if any of that stuff's been recorded, because there's supposed to be an access driveway through there and all kinds of crazy stuff.
Well, up north in Zell needs a hookup on one side of the building with that street that gets, what's the street that's parallel to the
Clinton.
Need a street that's perpendicular to Clinton so that the school has a secondary egress.
And remember, that was negotiated with the water company. And I don't know how far that went.
When?
Remember when we negotiated with the water company so they could put their slab in. They agreed to
along Clinton Street for the trucks.
They actually agreed to put in some sort of road access for the school district.
There's nothing on paper.
And rebuild the playground.
Yeah, but they never put it on paper though. Or did they?
That I don't know, because that was Michelle's thing, and Michelle Mayfield's long gone.
They couldn't find anything recorded.
Yeah, so that maybe nothing was recorded. But with this long checkered history of this property, does the city really want to deal with this?
Mr. Chairman.
Sir.
If I may, I could recommend to the managing director that if it's the pleasure of the commission, that conversation with the managing director and the chairman or designee, looking at you, Wayne, so at least we can have discussions about history that planning commission, particularly you know of, we can share that with the managing director, who can forward that up to council. If that's and the pleasure.
Yeah. I think it makes sense, because if members of this committee, this group, have been around during the times of discussions and negotiations and due diligence, the more information we can give to the city as they move forward,
absolutely,
is going to be in their best interests, because I certainly don't want us to make a bad decision, make a bad investment. The last thing the world we want is a city council who gets half the story. Mm-hmm. To give them all the facts as we remember them and recollect them. It's before my time. I don't know the details, but as you gentlemen have sat here and been a part of that review and approval process, or whatever your capacities were, the information we can share with the managing director and through the system makes more sense.
Yes.
Sure. I mean, the school board generally, responsible folks, but I think some of the judgments and decisions they make are misguided, because they never have the rest of the story. They don't have all the information. Mm.
Yeah. Well, so, the unfortunate thing is that a body run by politics, the decisions are made for political purposes as opposed to practical purposes. And I think that the school district needs to listen to, well, not the school district, forget the school district, the city of Reading. I don't want our council to make bad decisions. And I think we owe it to them as their planning commission to advise them as best we can with what we know.
Yeah. I'll get back to
so I think if you okay. can
arrange Yeah, I'll be glad to come in anytime.
Yeah. And I think I'll defer to you to pick those members of this group that I know the most.
Very good.
I'll just be there, look pretty. I'll wear a bow tie.
My follow-up question was, I was curious about this anyway, was what's the timetable on the River Road extension? We talked about it before.
Yeah, right now, the I think everybody knows what the River Road Extension project is. That's the road that's going to, we're talking about Clinton Street. Well, it picks up around Clinton. That's River Road. Takes it under the bridge and then up to where the new Lincoln Street extension will go. It's now the school district playground.
Right.
Lincoln Street's going to plow up through there. It's going to do a little switchback because it's a steep hill to climb.
Yeah.
Going to connect up to West Windsor Street and take you over to the new traffic signal at the bridge and get you up on the bridge and then the other way around. So you basically got a new jug handle going down to the industrial park that we're talking about, the Dana South.
There's that, another example. You're putting in the loop.
Yeah.
Designed for trucks.
Well, for it's for everybody, but yes, it'll accommodate trucks.
Designed for trucks.
That's the main goal
easier
here.
Easier access to loop around to line them up going north or Glenside to pick up bypass.
Yes, to keep them out of the residentials.
Oh, yes, the R1, absolutely. The
R3.
But then at the same time, the same proponent of that who lives in the area is giving argument now for a bridge in that area, the bridge that will never be built, the bridge that should have been built. Well, if that bridge is built, that gives that area a direct access to the bypass, and then therefore that negates the purpose of the loop-de-loop that's being designed and constructed now.
With all due respect, there are a lot of ifs involved, and
a lot of what?
Ifs.
Oh yeah, it's always
ifs.
Yeah. This project, the one I'm describing, is to be let this year. Okay, that's our goal, is to be digging this road on that quarry site that I'm talking about in the spring. Maybe this summer. Right now, we're still in a negotiation with land rights. We have to get our NPDES permit. It's a little bit of a struggle, but we got a good team. We got some good engineers, McCormick Taylor, and we're making some progress on it. I expect to be moving dirt this spring.
Well, my point is that it might not be needed by another action being taken. At the same time, look at the West Reading Bridge.
Yeah,
2 years after the bridge is completed,
if it ever gets built, that would be in the future. Yeah, that would be a long time in the future. In this, I think the city wants to see the Dana South site developed as soon as possible.
Well, I think this is a perfect opportunity for this group to do above and beyond just reviewing projects, but advise the city through our planning and through zoning, sit down and help them make the proper decisions. I think that's one of the things that this body has not been able to do. And you know, we have to speak our minds. We have to let them know what we know. And you know, Wayne, I've known you a long time, and you don't make stuff up. So you've heard things, you share things, you see what's going on. So I support the idea that we get and become a sounding board for what they want to do.
And another example, and I'm finished, is the school board on 9th Street for a school site. They have capacity right now for existing buildings that they have for their class schedule for a minimum of 1,250 additional students. Yeah, you have to do some busing, but the busing they're doing now, the magnet school, you're going down there. What are we busing in now? Fifth graders? Are we down to fifth grade now in that?
At
least six.
Next year is a complete redesign.
Well, that so, means a redesign.
So in the elementary schools, you will only have kindergarten through fourth. In the five middle schools, because the Citadel is going to become a middle school.
That's the one.
That will be fifth through eighth.
There you go.
And then the high school will be 9 through 12. This has nothing to do with the four magnet schools. The four magnet schools are still somehow off the table of negotiation, even though Pennsylvania Department of Education should have caught up with this a long time ago and made them do something with those buildings.
Well, my point is, you're busing kids now down to fifth grade. This whole district was a walking district for umpteen years. Okay.
Oh, you haven't seen busing yet until the Citadel turns into a middle school.
And when they took, it doesn't matter what buildings would turn into what. You know, I won't tell you who doesn't look at who. There's two reasons why you build schools, and I won't go into those two reasons. But
well, let's not get into
busing is being done. And they did not figure that when you have all day fifth grade, a fourth, you know, all year pre-kindergarten, right? What does that do to a room schedule? What does all day kindergarten do to the room schedule? Room schedule is the amount of rooms you need, the amount of area to accommodate educational programs with the holes through the body. You add bodies, you need more square. You need square, you need a building that has square. They didn't think of that. Somebody didn't feel, I could have figured it out without a calculator, and they didn't do it. Now they're jammed up. And my point is that this building's empty, that building's empty, that was half, that. You put it together, you have accommodation right now for 1,250. Those schools were built to accommodate that many bodies. Those magnet schools that are sitting there, two of them, were designed for capacity of 350 students. You've got the one out of City Line, that's sitting there, that can handle at least 350 because they had the design for minimum of 350.
As far as I know, City Line is being used for the alternative education.
Well, it's used for something else, but you can you parcel it out somewhere else. What are they doing with Tom Ford? Thomas Ford is sitting there, that school, I think that building can accommodate at least 500, 550, maybe a little more, but 550. It's sitting there, it's used as an auxiliary truck depot for food service trucks every night, they're there. And it's also used for an auxiliary large truck parking lot for the maintenance department. And the schoolhouse is sitting there with broken windows, with plywood in it, rotting, decaying. They only ever did one thing since that school was built in 52, and in addition in 57, 58, they replaced the roof when they absolutely had to. Nothing else would ever done it in that building.
All right, I don't want to spend all night solving the school district's problems.
Did I do that?
No, but you should go. You should go and tell them what you know. This is amazing. I mean, if this is common knowledge, what the hell are they doing in all their facilities meetings and all of their committee structure and replanning and blah, 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 and laying things out?
I'm going to keep it real short because I don't want to get too far into it either. But the magnet school is a point well taken, but it's true there are other buildings like Thomas Ward and then the one on City Line, the former Jewish Community Center. It's only used for the therapeutic school. It's like 20, 30 students for the whole building. And then there's the question about the buildings that are underutilized, like the whatever they call it at 8th and Penn, not the administration building, but the
that's
one
empty.
It's mostly empty.
Yeah.
And then further on top of that, something I didn't think of.
10th and Penn, the old.
The old farmer's
market. The market.
Okay.
Right, the Vernon Farmer's
Center market. For children. Yeah.
Right. And then on top of that is the question about expanding, like 10th and Green, like we approved, put the modular in there. The question about the pros and cons, everything. Could they expand on some of the properties? I mean, the one at City Line, that's 17 acres. But I mean, closer to the where they're thinking about here. So those are all the questions that have we've been thinking about this, as far as what is really the need, how they're going to change boundaries in light of this whole reorganization and everything that we would want to know. I'm sure the public would too.
So if someone has a name, please, I'll supply it.
Selman?
That's
someone is retiring soon.
Yes.
And well, he's moving that position. Yeah. So that being said, you know, maybe it's a good time to step in and, you know, with the transition between the outgoing and the incoming, it's a good time to develop a dialogue.
Oh, the facilities director.
Yes.
He's actually the assistant superintendent. Summer's the assistant superintendent.
Summer was the assistant, he's leaving or left already, and Todd Conner, you're saying, has been
back. Friday's his last day.
Okay.
Who left?
Yeah, Chris Summer's leaving, and actually Public Works is meeting with him on his way out. We're trying to do a little transition. We try to work out conducting parent pickup and drop off and a little bit of how to mark the streets and helping out with crosswalks as much as we can at Public Works.
So Todd Kahn is leaving, or has
no, not Todd Kahn, Chris Selmer.
Oh, Chris Selmer.
Chris Selmer, okay. Assistant superintendent.
Does he have a date?
I think Friday is, I think Chris said Friday is it for him. And he's moving on to Harrisburg.
Not the facility director.
Yeah, Todd Kahn is still there as far as I know.
Vice principal.
Superintendent. Assistant superintendent.
I think about $24 to $26 million just on 10th and Green to do things that have that should have been done years ago.
So I can, or we can,
yes,
reach out to the school district and ask for a meeting to discuss issues of common interest.
I have a very good relationship with Chris and also Khalid as well.
Yeah, I think we should reach out, Mr. Chairman. And again, this body should elevate itself in all things planning in the city, and I would, you know, encourage us to work together along that line.
Okay.
I don't know where we are here, Jeff.
I have nothing to report for Blighted Property Review Committee. We didn't meet. Next is you, update by Acting Community Development Director David Hunter. Do you want to tell us about what's going on in community development?
A few things. So we'll start again with a formal thank you to the Planning Commission for supporting the briefing on the housing and blight study. By all accounts, the presentation went very well. The support was overwhelming, and I again thank you personally and sincerely for your support. That is a model for the moving Reading forward. We have to work together. I've said that since day one. It's going to take a team. It's going to take, you know, a village to raise this child Reading up from where it is to where we think it should be, to maturity, developmental maturity, if you will. So again, thank you. We're going to Community of the Whole, scheduled for 3rd of September, and hope to get to public hearing by the end of September. And if that sounds aggressive, it is. We don't want to lose any momentum. We have the support of the stakeholders that are vested in helping to redevelop the city. I think we need to take advantage of that momentum. So that's one, thank you for that. Two, I want to mention a couple of things. I am looking to meet with the new president of Alvernia University. The president is in town, and we look to meet with him to discuss, again, improvements at Alvernia and the plan for expansion. So that's exciting. So that's a big piece. Another anchor institution is Albright. We had a representative for the owner here tonight. I want to encourage the commission, because there's a number for disturbance that is not codified. And so the applicant shared with me after the meeting that he was under the impression that the disturbance number was X, and they actually revised their plans to be below X. And he heard tonight that the number is Y. And so if there's a frustration from an applicant, and we heard from another applicant tonight, just using him as an example, frustration is that the rules keep changing or shifting. And so we don't, as I understand it, have a number, a hard and fast codified number for land disturbance for stormwater management. I hope I said that correctly. It's a policy that we use, the number of 1,200, but it's not codified. and I think we really need to codify that number and substantiate that number so that it makes it easier for applicants to know what's the target. Because we are not, if we're not lock sync with the other entities in government, I mean zoning, planning, public works, fire marshal, billion trades, everyone is in lockstep. And applicant hears one thing in one stop and leaves one stop with an understanding, and that's not consistent with the planning commission, then I think we need to think long and hard about that. So I would just encourage the commission to look at a meeting with the chairman about guidelines and bylaws. That's something that I would urge the commission to consider.
Well said. Other business, review of any draft meeting minutes, May 18, October 18, November 18, and open discussion at the discretion of the board, which I think we've had. Any zoning hearing board updates?
As of this point, Mr. Chairman, there's none.
Okay. Any future cases coming before us? Planning Commission case updates?
The Planning Commission updates I've included in the back of the staff comments is an update on the property that Mr. Ponce was talking about this evening, 1722 North 10th Street, the property of Mr. Mercedes. Currently, Public Works is working with both the city solicitor and the city managing director to come to an agreement over the vacation, the portion of Moss Street that overlays his property. So they're weaving whatever they do. So we expect to hear from them hopefully soon. I know soon is not a time, but you know, with the way that they're stressed, we'll go with soon. But as of this point though, the zoning director has, or an administrator has also expressed some concern that it's an ongoing violation and something needs to be done. We were out there the other day and we do have photos. I mean, I could put them up, but it's gonna take a few minutes. The Moss Street section of the property had a chain across it. That chain is now down and they have cones up, so clearly it's being used. There's more stone on the property. The wheel stops bumpers are in, not only for the sidewalk, but for marking the individual lanes. Included in your packet was a enforcement letter because there were people fixing their vehicles on the site, washing them. So they are not in compliance. So I think there's a situation where we need to sit down with zoning and figure out a strategy to bring them into compliance at some point before we move forward.
Well, I have a question. We know they're not in compliance and it's been several years. Why don't not this body, the appropriate authorities, enact a cease and desist?
There's a process for zoning enforcement, and staff is following that process.
They are following it?
Yes.
And it does include?
Includes going to court.
Okay.
And so you have a process where a district judge may fine a violator and then waive it. Or, you know, it's complicated and it's not the process that we would like. And so to shut someone down, as I've been asked to do, it's not that simple.
We understand that. That costs us money.
Yes.
No matter what the outcome is, it costs us money. And it's a value judgment. What are these things worth? It's going to cost us.
Correct.
A five minute of fame concerning the water issue at that time. It's $47,000. We don't forget. We don't forget what the threat of contempt of court means, too.
But zoning is asking for a planning cooperation to not just grant an approval when there have been violations, plural. if so, to hold this applicant's feet to the fire, we have recommendations from zoning on conditions for approval. So even prior to approval, the applicant needs to be held accountable.
Anything else, Adam?
No, then. Let's do it.
All right. Is there anything from the group to go to the order?
Do we make motions on minutes? We normally did.
Oh, did we?
I'm sorry, I missed that. Normally you do.
Normally we make a motion to approve the minutes.
Yeah.
We can make a single motion to approve all three of these.
Okay. I make a motion to approve the May, October, and November 2018 minutes as presented.
I'll second. All right, any discussion? All those in favor of approval of the meeting minutes as delineated by the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Is there anything more to come before the commission this evening?
Just in relation to the minutes, I just want to mention for the record, as Will often likes these kind of things. The intern who worked on the minutes did a great job. He did incorporate the changes that I sent months and months ago. And I went back to those emails, and it was very thoroughly done and well presented. So thanks to the intern for his hard work.
Yes. Okay. We are adjourned. See you again.